Vampirism, the pathological thirst for human blood, is often associated with the semi-mythical figure of Count Dracula. However, there are historical instances where vampires were specific and real individuals. One such case is the Roman Emperor Claudius Nero Tiberius, who ruled from 14 to 37 AD. He embodied human vices. The emperor was notorious for his cruelty, mistrust, suspicion, shrewdness, hypocrisy, and extreme perversity. In his youth and adulthood, Tiberius engaged in unrestrained nocturnal orgies, during which he enjoyed biting the arteries of young girls and extracting their blood. According to contemporaries, he became more intoxicated from this than from wine. Considering the power he held, one can only imagine the extent of these gruesome celebrations. His monstrous lifestyle left a mark on him. Towards the end of his rule, even though he wasn't old, Tiberius had become frail, suffering from numerous diseases. He lost all his hair and teeth. Yet, he couldn't forsake his vampiric tendencies. Every day, morning and night, the emperor consumed two large goblets, up to 1.5 liters each, of a concoction made from women's milk and the blood of young girls, whose arteries were opened just before preparing the infernal mixture. Additionally, the pervert would bathe in the same mixture several times a day, heated to 40-50 degrees Celsius. Secluded on a heavily guarded Mediterranean island, surrounded by Praetorian bodyguards, Tiberius ignored matters of state. His pathologies were compounded by a manic desire for immortality. His fear wasn't so much of death itself, but of the dreadful punishments he believed he'd face in the afterlife for his sacrilegious acts. This obsession led to the deaths of thousands, perhaps tens of thousands, of infants, boys, and girls. The tyrant believed that consuming young blood would rejuvenate him, but this was a cruel misconception. Claudius Nero Tiberius suffocated in the blood of his innocent victims. Undoubtedly, vampires exist in our era. Numerous examples attest to this fact. Here are a few instances, detailed in foreign and partially domestic media. In the autumn of 1989, Australia was shocked by the crime of Tracy Wiggishton from Brisbane. The 25-year-old student seduced 47-year-old Clyde Baldock. Late on October 21st, she lured him to a secluded riverside spot where she mercilessly struck him 15 times in the neck, nearly severing his head, before drinking his blood. It later emerged that the girl, who suffered brutal abuse from her grandparents as a child, was a Satanist. She wore a chain with the image of a ram's head, a symbol of Satan, with bright red eyes. Vampires favor red. On her arm, Wiggishton carved a pentagram, Satan's symbol, with a knife. She chose October 21 deliberately, as it is considered by Satan's cult followers to be the eve of All Saints' Day. Tracy Wiggington received a life sentence for her crime. Germany is still grappling with the story of Lorca. Neighbors long found his behavior odd. He slept during the day and wandered the streets at night, insisting people call him Count. He was viewed as a harmless eccentric until a dramatic incident unfolded, exposing his true nature. Initially, the police didn't believe a bloody homeless man who came to the station, claiming he had almost fallen prey to a vampire, assuming he was just drunk. However, a doctor confirmed that the monstrous wound on the homeless man's neck was caused by human teeth. Lorca had lured the vagrant into his house, promising food, then clutched his throat in a death grip. The victim lost consciousness, and when he woke, Lorca had drunk his blood. The vampire, without removing the body, went to bed. The homeless man escaped and reported to the police. Lorca, his face smeared with blood, was peacefully asleep when apprehended. For the past 2 years, Hungary has been gripped by a gruesome series of events in Miskolc, where a vampire killer claimed 16 lives. The monster's identity was only recently revealed when he was found dead with a dagger in his heart. Bernard Wessig. This seemingly virtuous resident of Miskolc confessed in a suicide note that he had an insatiable thirst for blood, which drove him to kill and drink the blood of his victims. In a recent case, a 45-year-old Moscow nurse, considered an exemplary worker, was caught drinking blood from a syringe by her colleague. When confronted, she lunged at him, grabbing his throat. Colleagues had to intervene to subdue the hysterical nurse. It was discovered that she had been consuming human blood for years, taking it from patients under the guise of medical tests. The causes of vampirism remain elusive, with limited scientific study on the topic. The only significant research center in the world focused on this phenomenon is in New York. This center continuously monitors 25 patients whom we can term peaceful vampires. They lead ordinary lives, including jobs and families, and only occasionally require fresh blood, typically from animals or birds. Some even mutually donate blood to each other. The underlying anomalies driving this behavior remain unidentified. The patients share an intolerance to garlic, which breaks down blood fats, suggesting a potential avenue for understanding vampire killers worldwide are considered psychotic individuals with a pathological craving for human flesh and blood. They rarely face justice due to the extreme danger they pose. Information about them is kept confidential to avoid public panic. Typically, vampire killers are confined to psychiatric clinics in strict isolation.
Zoya went from Noginsk to Moscow by train. She was going to buy suitable shoes. She had a trip to the Black Sea ahead of her, and it was also pleasant to wander around the city center among the smart summer crowd. After all, it was the capital, not the quiet city of Weaver's Noginsk. On Kuznetsky Bridge, the girl bought an ice cream, and without hurrying anywhere, moved towards Teatralnaya Square. Suddenly, she was called by an attractive man in his 30s. "I'm sorry to address you so easily." He smiled and walked beside her. "You know, I saw you and immediately realized that you were just what we needed." Zoya was a little embarrassed and confused. She didn't like to get acquainted on the street. Usually in such situations, she didn't keep the conversation going and quickly left. But the friendly look of the man, the pleasant timbre of his voice, and his solid manners calmed her down. The stranger looked little like a street Don Juan. "Just a few questions," the man continued. "They won't oblige you to anything." He stopped, took out a small book with gold embossing from the breast pocket of his windbreaker, and introduced himself. "Eduard Lvovich Chapigin, director of the Mosfilm Film Studio." "Zoya." "Fine, Zoya. Now I'll explain everything to you." It was like a gift from fate. They walked slowly along Petrovka, and in front of her unfolded pictures, one more tempting than the other. Zoya, it turned out, was exactly what a heroine should be according to the script of a Russian-French movie. "The plot is quite simple," said Eduard Lvovich, with a meaningful look at the young interlocutor. "Two school friends, the daughter of a diplomat and a student of Stroganovka, meet after a long break. Inquiries, conversations about hobbies, novels, Beau. By the way, how do you feel about erotica?" "No, don't get the wrong idea. No dirt, we have. Pure art." The director interrupted the conversation only occasionally, as if casually asked about her parents' pastime. When he learned that she is studying at vocational school and now on vacation, clearly pleased. "How fortunate! I think we will have time to complete the shooting before the beginning of the school year." Even more, Eduard Lvovich revived when he heard that Zoya is already 16 and she has a boyfriend. "So you don't need to explain where children come from?" chuckled the director, and noticing the embarrassment on the girl's face, hastily continued. "The movie is not designed for elementary school children. There will be a few bed scenes, quite daring. And what about me?" "Nothing that you have never filmed," interrupted Zoya, director. "The courage of the city takes. Trust my experience, you are made for the movie. However, you can see for yourself. Right now, let's go to the studio and make an audition." Noticing on the girl's face some wariness, the benefactor, like a magician in the buffoonery, pulled out of his sleeve trump ace. "Make up your mind, the second such chance in life may not be." 9 days later, the film crew begins working on location in Paris. This argument dispelled the last doubts. The future movie star made a choice. From the testimony of Zoe F., even before the trip to the apartment, the director took me into some entranceway and suggested that I portray a blind woman, a newborn, a young woman. He commented on my actions, guided me, prompted me. Then he asked me to strip down to my waist. I took off my shirt and t-shirt. The director looked at and touched my breasts, complimented me. But then we heard some noise and I quickly got dressed. On the way out, the director held out two pills in the palm of my hand. He said that I might have to drink champagne in the studio, and I needed a fresh head and clear coordination of movements. The pills, he explained, neutralized the effects of alcohol. When we arrived at the apartment, the director treated me to strong coffee and then gave me an open swimsuit and told me to change. Then Edward Lvovich asked me to portray a tightrope walker while he was filming me with a movie camera. I began to feel that I was in some kind of lethargic state, but I could not shake up, overcome the lethargy. The director stripped naked and offered to go to bed with him. When I objected, he persuasively explained that he needed to make sure I was relaxed. Having taken off my swimsuit, he started kissing my breasts and face, asked if I lived with guys. From the materials of the criminal case, taking advantage of the fact that Zoya F., after taking pills, ceased to realize the essence and nature of the actions committed with her and to direct her actions, the rapist committed sexual acts with her in the usual and perverted form. While F. was dressing, he examined her belongings but found nothing of value. The actions of the accused in this episode were qualified by the investigation under Article 117.4 of the Zucker SFSR as rape of a minor in a helpless state. Having satisfied himself with the tests, the molester took the girl, who had been drugged with psychotropic drugs, out of the house and left her at the nearest bus stop. Yerevan-born Valery Azratyan had nothing to do with movies. But from his early childhood, he showed great interest in the issues of sex and satisfaction of his own lust was his main goal in life. Later, during the examination of the maniac in the Institute of Special and Forensic Psychiatry, his biography was carefully studied, and from conversations with the patient medics learned many important facts. Azratyan was born in an intelligent family. His parents gave him a lot of attention and affection, especially since the child grew up weak and sickly. Adults very early began to note the boy's special interest in sex. The kindergarten teachers complained that he liked to seclude himself with girls and play hospital games with them, undressing, examining, and touching their genitals. According to Azratyan's confession, he liked to peep at the girls. He would specially ride in a crowded bus to casually grope the women squeezed in the crowd. Already at the age of 13, he had his first sexual experience. Partner was 28-year-old acquaintance who committed with him oral intercourse. From the age of 14, Azratyan met women constantly. Sociable, impulsive, with a lively mind and intelligence high enough for his age, he easily found girlfriends among his classmates, housemates, sportswomen who swam with him in the pool. Most of the girls, fearing unwanted pregnancy, preferred sexual contacts in an unconventional form, which suited Azratyan. Back in high school, he became interested in psychology, which later helped him to easily establish contact with strangers. Azratyan successfully entered the Armenian State Pedagogical Institute and graduated with a diploma in preschool psychology and pedagogy. He did not change his passions while studying at the university, was in constant search, and gained fame among fellow students as a playboy. Almost every day he met with a new partner and was considered an experienced heartbreaker and a real man. However, already in the institute, Azratyan himself began to be interested in adult women less and less. He was attracted to teenage girls. Knowing literature well, he found much in common between himself and the hero of the famous Lolita by Vladimir Nabokov. He was unrestrainedly attracted to girls nymphetnoknogo age, 10 to 14 years old. Realizing what such passion would lead to, Azratyan tried to get away from obsessive thoughts. But he could not do anything with himself. From the materials of the criminal case, after graduating from the institute in 1980, Azratyan worked for some time as a teacher educator in a boarding school for children suffering from the effects of poliomyelitis and cerebral palsy. In 1981, he married a Muscovite and moved to the capital. From that moment, and began the career of a director. Twice in 1982 and 1985, Azratyan was convicted of committing lewd acts against underage girls in Moscow. After serving his second term, he received a residence permit in the town of Valaki, Belgorod region, but of course he had no intention of living in the middle of nowhere. In 1988, Azratyan returned to Moscow. His wife refused to accept him, and he got together with Marina Agaeva, a cashier at a grocery store. Soon, 40-year-old Agaeva and her 14-year-old daughter became his concubines and took turns faithfully realizing the sexual whims of the pervert. A little later, the mother and daughter, intimidated by the cynical cohabitant, turned into accomplices, helping the director to select the next applicant for the main role in the adult movie. Azratyan met his future victims in the center of Moscow. his favorite place of hunting, the store Children's World, where there are a lot of naive provincials and just pretty girls. Possessing an imposing appearance and confidence, bordering on swagger, he introduced himself as a producer or director of Moss Film. Then, depending on the contact interlocutor, offered shooting in the movie and a trip to Venice, Paris, or Berlin. The prospect of a trip abroad at the expense of the studio made Pliable most cautious and distrustful. Then, according to the script, worked out to the last detail. Azrat Jan brought an unsuspecting girl to the apartment of his assistant, Marina Ageva, where the main events unfolded. The cohabitant was preparing film equipment and light for filming, and the director quickly brewed strong coffee and gallantly offered it to the future star of the screen. Before that, Azratyan slipped a devilish mixture of potent psychotropic drugs into the cup. The victim drank the invigorating drink, noting its strangely bitter taste, and fell into a semi-conscious state. Then the tests began. From the materials of the criminal case, to facilitate criminal activity, Azratyan used drugs of sleeping pills or psychotropic properties. He learned about their effects on the human psyche from the Handbook of Drugs Used in Medical Practice in the USSR. This book, among other material evidence, is attached to the case. More often than others, Azratyan used neuroleptics, tranquilizers, sedatives, antidepressants. Depending on the purpose, he used pills in various combinations and doses. Initially, one of the drugs was mixed into coffee, and after the girls became ill, Azratyan forced them to take more pills under various pretexts, which finally stupefied the victims. Some victims were in a helpless state for several hours, others, 3 or 4 days, during which the maniac used them for sexual experiments at any convenient moment for him. At first, he got acquainted with the girls on his own. He chose provincial girls, residents of the Moscow suburbs, business travelers who came to Moscow for shopping or on a tour. They were poorly oriented in the city. They were easier to get in touch with. Soon he guessed that it was even easier to process the victim in pairs with a cohabitant, more convincing and fun. And later, Agaeva's mentally ill minor daughter Tatiana was also involved in recruitment. The girl was used by Azratyan not only as a planted duck, the director presented her as the second heroine of the movie, but also to obtain prescriptions. Tatiana suffered from a serious illness, needed medical supervision, and constantly took various psychotropic drugs. She was panically afraid of Azratyan and went to the polyclinic to get prescriptions at the first request. From Azratyan's testimony, mother and daughter helped to create confidence in the girls that we were really a film crew. We agreed in advance who should do what. In addition, Marina and Tanya had to help the girls, take them to the toilet, feed them. Under the influence of pills, some of them had involuntary urination, drooled. We had to wash laundry and clothes, clean the apartment, monitor their condition. Such entertainments, even considering the modest props and minimal expenses for the captives, required constant expenses. It is clear that no one provided Azratyan with champagne and medicines for free. Besides, the director, who did not work anywhere, wanted to look like a successful maestro of the capital's elite. That's why he preferred well-dressed girls with jewelry for acquaintance. Having enjoyed himself, he, with the help of his cohabitant, dressed helpless captives in rags, took off their rings, earrings, pendants, and finally, pouring into their mouths a shocking dose of poison, drove them out of the house. He always led them by roundabout ways so that the victim could not, under any circumstances, find the house or remember the road on which they were led. It is necessary to give credit to Azratyan's art. Only a few of the victims were able to reconstruct the details of the disaster. For the maniac, there was no difference between a 14-year-old child and a 23-year-old student. They were just objects that the criminal used at his pleasure. His games became more and more disgusting. The pervert's satiated fantasy forced him to involve his cohabitant in his bedtime activities. He watched the scenes of lesbian caresses with interest, joined later, and organized orgies according to his own scenario. Once he managed to get two girls' friends into the shooting room at once, Azratyan communicated with them in various combinations, after which he sent them away from home in turn, drugging them with sleeping powders. For one of the victims, the lengthy movie tryouts ended in pregnancy. The underage girl, who hid her meeting with the director from her parents, reported it too late. Doctors did not risk an abortion, and she turned out to be the mother of the child of the maniac who raped her. At some point, Azratyan realized that it was no longer enough to take the drugged victim away from home to cover up his crimes. The episodes were counted by dozens, and there were more and more witnesses. And now, to remain at large, he decided to kill. Having raped and robbed another girl, he prepares a powder of 80 pills, takes a bottle of water, and drags the victim, who is barely walking, to the suburban train to Tsaritsino station. Before boarding the car under the guise of kefir, he makes the girl swallow a lethal dose of sleeping pills. Then, like a caring father, brings the girl into the car and puts her on a bench. When the train moves, Azratyan remains on the platform, and his victim goes to die. In addition to the two brutal murders, the third girl, whom the director strangled with a belt, miraculously survived. The investigation proved 5 more attempted murders. Fortunately, the 5 victims were lucky. They were saved by 2 circumstances. Too large a dose injected into them scumbag. The body simply did not take the poison in such quantities, and medical help arrived in time. True, a few days the girls were between life and death, and doctors initially gave very disappointing prognoses. In total, there are 17 episodes in the criminal case, so many applications were received by the police. 8 of them, deadly duplicates, not brought to an end in spite of Azratyan's efforts. The victims were confused, poorly remembered the details, and gave only approximate descriptions of the pervert's appearance. Based on the scanty, scattered testimonies, the detective still managed to make a sketch and find out the hunting territory of the director. Having learned that he appears to be an employee of Mosfilm, went to the personnel department of the studio. MUR officers Sergei Karasev, Vyacheslav Zaitsev, Sergei Losev looked through thousands of personal files, trying to find at least some clue. In the center, near the store's Children's World, Petrovsky Passage, on Kuznetsky Bridge and Pushkinskaya Street, under the guise of bored provincials, walked police officers. But the rapist did not go to the net, and the number of victims was growing. Crushed by misfortune, parents brought their children to Petrovka, 38, asked to find the pervert, offered their help. Finally, luck smiled on the detectives. One of the girls was not too confident, but still managed to show the street and the house where the shooting took place. They set up surveillance and were soon convinced that they were on the right track. The man, who looked like a sketch of a maniac, was often in the field of vision of the police. They took him in the park near the Bolshoi Theater when he seduced another victim. Vladimir Pogrebnyak, head of the MUR department, approached Azratyan and called out, "Director, here we go." At that moment, the detectives handcuffed him. He tried to break free. He had a lot of physical strength, but soon calmed down, and already in the car, on the way to Petrovka 38, he suddenly said, "Are you interested in murders? I'm ready to tell you." The operatives, who had no information about the murders at the time, were surprised by the director's talkativeness. His sincerity was explained simply. Azratyan was very reluctant to go to the community center. He was afraid of being put in a common cell with other prisoners. He knew that he would have to answer for the mockery of children. Not only according to the laws of the state, his cellmates would charge him. The next day, the maniac led to the murder scene in Bitsa, where he strangled and stabbed to death a 17-year-old orphan for fear of being exposed. Another time, Azratyan drowned a student in the bathtub, and he did it so plausibly that forensic experts assumed an accident. During the preliminary investigation, Azratyan sat in a cell without neighbors, like a spider in a jar. Only for a short time he was compacted, a copy like him, a murderer of several women in Moscow. The court sentenced the director to an exceptional measure of punishment. The murderer and rapist did not apply for pardon. In the story of Azratyan, which has no analogs in the practice of domestic criminalists, there is one tragic detail. Outwardly, the mechanism of the search for victims by the director resembled the actions of the most productive serialists. Dense, sometimes many days' contact with the object, finding out the range of his interests, luring by false promises to the place of the crime. But this is where the similarity ends. If Chikatilo, Golovin, Slivko, Ryakovsky preferred to deal with degraded, drunken women, troubled teenagers, prostitutes, or weak-minded vagrants, Asratyan's victims cannot be attributed to the so-called risk group. Having studied the case well, I noticed that none of the girls who fell for the director had any negative characteristic. None of them were not registered with a narcologist in a psychiatric clinic, have not been to see a venereologist. They have not received complaints at their place of residence, and at school, at work, or at the institute, girls were known as honest, disciplined, and well-mannered people. They just really wanted to be in the movies.
This is the time when a person grows up, develops, approaches adolescence. This is the time of trying one's own strength, the time of finding a favorite pursuit, a goal in life. And Karol Stefan Kot, a boy from the Polish city of Krakow, famous for its sausages, also found a pursuit to his liking during this period. However, it was murder and blood. How does the urge to kill arise at such an early age, and how dangerous can a juvenile monster be? Why did the vampire from Krakow manage to evade punishment for so long? Karol Kot was born on December 18, 1946 in Krakow. It was in this city that he would spend his entire short life, and it was this city that he would terrorize with his horrifying attacks. The boy's father was an engineer, his mother was a housewife who was engaged in raising Karol and his sister, who was 8 years younger. Karol was quite a model boy, performed well in school, although he had difficulties in interacting with his peers. However, during his adolescent years, everything changed. The boy began to develop a strong interest in weapons, particularly knives. He started collecting them, and later, after visiting a slaughterhouse located not far from a place where his family liked to go during the summer, he began to use the weapons he had accumulated, torturing animals, including his sister's cats. That summer, Karol went to the slaughterhouse as if to work. He enjoyed observing the actions of the butchers and asked them to share their professional secrets, which they willingly did. It was at the slaughterhouse that the boy first tasted blood. The butcher collected blood in a mug and offered Karol to drink it. He expected the boy to be frightened, but Karol did the opposite. He drank the blood, shocking the slaughterhouse workers. This incident left a deep impression on him and led him to make a firm decision. His calling was to kill. While in high school, Kot joined the local shooting club, again, due to his fascination with firearms. He dreamed of becoming a military man, hoping that it would legally allow him to fulfill his desires for killing. However, he eventually decided not to wait for admission to an officer's school and began his terrible career. The first victim of the Polish maniac was 48-year-old Helen Welgen. Karol immediately decided to target only the vulnerable, women, preferably elderly, and children, as they couldn't resist him effectively. At the time of his first attack, Kot was 17 years old. The incident took place in a church. The boy stabbed the unfortunate woman several times in the back while she was kneeling in prayer. He chose this method of attack so that the victim wouldn't see his face. By chance, the woman managed to survive. Karol was so pleased with his actions that he struck again just 2 days later. This time, his victim was 78-year-old Franciszka Lewandowska, whom he stabbed in the back as she was climbing the stairs to her house. Despite being wounded, she also survived. Both women who survived the attacks later identified a certain young man as their assailant. 6 days after his previous attack, Kot struck again. His target this time was 86-year-old Maria Plishta, and this time, the attack proved fatal. Karol was clearly dissatisfied with his victim surviving and feeling weak. Therefore, when he finally achieved a fatal result, the maniac was delighted. He was so pleased that he went into hiding for a year and a half. He had had his fill of the sensations he experienced. He even visited the dying Maria in the hospital to revel in the outcome of his actions. Despite the audacity of these knife attacks, the police were unable to apprehend the culprit. 17 months after Maria Plishta's murder, Karol decided to resume killing. This time, his victim was an 11-year-old boy named Leszek Sielek. The child was sledding down a hill when the maniac approached him and stabbed him 11 times. This murder was particularly brutal, unlike his previous attacks. Evidently, the enforced break was difficult for this vocational maniac, and he wanted to make up for the months of inactivity. Interestingly, during a family dinner, Karol's father, shocked by the child's murder, remarked, "Only a complete bastard could have done that," not realizing that this degenerate was seated right next to him. Karol simply grinned, Kot concluded that it was easier to attack children. 2 months later, he assaulted an 8-year-old girl named Malgosia with a knife, stabbing her 8 times. There's an infernal arithmetic in this. The number of stabbings matched the victim's age. Perhaps Karol Kot saw some special significance in this pattern. Fortunately, the girl survived. The attacker was also seen by a passing cab driver, who observed Kot licking the bloody knife after his gruesome act. The events in West Krakow left the community in shock. Women were afraid to go out alone, and parents wouldn't let their children attend school. However, the Krakow vampire was clearly dissatisfied with the results of his deeds. He wanted to kill more people. Many more. Karol Kot came up with the idea of using poison to increase his body count. He attempted to poison bottles of water with a lethal dose of arsenic, and then placed them in local cafes and bars. He also discreetly added arsenic to partially consumed glasses left on bar counters, hoping someone would unknowingly drink from them. However, all these attempts failed. The killer then decided on a more direct approach and offered poisoned water to a classmate. Fortunately, the classmate detected an unusual odor, suspected foul play, and refrained from drinking the water. Moreover, the maniac made repeated attempts to set residential and commercial buildings on fire, hoping to cause mass casualties. Once again, he was unsuccessful. The fires never broke out. It appeared that Karol Kot was destined to evade justice for an extended period. The police were unable to trace the vampire terrorizing Krakow. Love, however, played a pivotal role in exposing the maniac. Karol was infatuated with a girl from his school named Danuta. He frequently conversed with her, and would boast about his peculiar interests. He might say things like, "I want to kill." But for some reason, the girl didn't take these statements seriously, assuming he was merely joking. Only when the maniac confessed to attacking a girl, an incident that became the talk of the town, Danuta finally realized that it wasn't a joke and decided to contact the police. Karol was arrested on June 1, 1966, just a day after he passed his matriculation exams. The timing of his arrest was deliberate, as it aimed to establish his mental competence and adulthood. In his home, authorities discovered a substantial collection of weapons, including 16 knives, along with an anatomy atlas and excerpts containing information about fatal wounds. Initially, the Krakow maniac denied the accusations, but as surviving victims identified him and a taxi driver recalled seeing him fleeing the scene of his last attack, he began to confess. Karol Kot admitted to committing 2 murders, attempting to murder 10 individuals, and engaging in 4 arson attacks. Strangely, he even had some defenders at first, such as the coach of the shooting club he had attended. After reading a letter in his defense written by the coach, the maniac laughed and remarked, "If he only knew that his son was also on my list." After undergoing psychological and psychiatric evaluations, it was determined that the perpetrator was mentally sound and fully aware of his actions. During investigative reenactments, Karol acted like a star, orchestrating the movements of photographers and cameramen. He eagerly demonstrated how he had killed or wounded his victims, clearly deriving pleasure from the dramatization. The only thing missing for this juvenile monster was real human blood. During his trial, the vampire of Krakow was questioned about his guilty conscience and whether he saw himself as an evil and aggressive person. In response, Karol shared his unconventional ideas about morality and ethics. He believed that true evil resided in those who frequented prostitutes and alcoholics. He considered himself a murderer, but not evil, simply because he pursued what he desired most. Additionally, Kot believed that there was a perverse beauty and pleasure in human suffering and pain. He saw himself as an artist who translated this beauty into reality. Despite his grandiose declarations, these philosophical stances failed to sway the court. Karol Kot was sentenced to death by hanging. The defense appealed the decision, leading to the sentence being initially commuted to life imprisonment. However, due to widespread public outrage, the original sentence was reinstated. Karol Kot was executed by hanging on May 16, 1968. Prior to his death, he remarked, "I experienced the incredible pleasure of plunging a knife into flesh. This experience is worth the gallows."